Hear these words from Psalm 98. Oh, sing to God a new song, for our Maker has done marvelous things. And now, here are some announcements for our lives together. Connect cards are located on the back table, and a link to a digital one will be dropped in the chat for those joining us on Zoom. Our new website is now live. So go check it out. Let me know what you think. Hopefully it will be useful to you. Leftover Kroger gift cards are available for purchase to help raise money for Guns to Gardens. They come in $50 increments. Talk to Patrick if you want to buy some for your own grocery shopping, gas, and pharmacy needs. Please mark your calendars for these two upcoming events. First, The annual fundraiser to benefit Presbyterian Peace Camp at Pine Crest, which is Camp Food and Cocktails, on Sunday, October 20th at Shady Grove Press Church. It's going to be from 5 to 7 p.m., and details will be in the newsletter, or you can talk with Patrick. And second, there will be a showing of the documentary Cook, Survivable by Zip Code, which explores the climate crisis and environmental racism right here on Monday, October 21st. And doors open at 6 p.m. The film starts at 6:30. Light refreshments will be available, and the event is free. You can talk to Patrick for more information. Choir practice happens here on Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. So if you have a song in your heart, please join us. And now I invite up Patrick for an announcement.
Good morning. If you're visiting, I'm Patrick. I'm the pastor here at Evergreen. And just one quick announcement about part of our send-off for our beloved Mr. Corey. When we asked in staff meeting a few weeks ago what Corey would like to feel loved, he said, just notes, just people writing notes to him, which is very much a testament to who he is as a person, because, you know, I would have been like, well, checks, obviously. We are doing both of those options. You can write notes to Corey, and those can go in this basket. I'm going to start passing them around. There's some pens. The notes that have already been written are in here in the envelopes, but there's plenty of envelopes and note cards and pens, so I'm going to start on this side with Pastor Beatrix. Write a note to him, and then put him in the offering plate later in the service. And then this is a love offering. I know a lot of folks have given online. There's information in your bulletin on how to give online to the love offering, which is just a more... churchy way of saying we want to send them away with a little bit of money. So this basket's going to go around if you have cash or checks, and then, like I said, information on how to give digitally as well. So I'm going to pass this around starting right now. And then if you have another note that you want to send to Corey, a note of love or something else you want to offer, talk to him or talk to me. He might have a lot on his mind this morning. Or talk to me, and we'll make sure that any gift or anything you want to do for him, that it makes its way to Corey. Thanks, y'all.
And now I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we bring in the light. God's spirit produces the albums of our lives.
And as we become friends, God mashes up our songs.
God delights in the quirky mixtape that is Evergreen.
And we give thanks for everyone who's featured in the music.
We gather this morning to worship God, the loving producer.
And to celebrate the work God has done through Corey.
As our friend and brother moves to the next track,
we trust that God will be with him, continuing to inspire his song.
Please remain standing as you are comfortable and able for our opening hymn, a tribute to music and song, hymn number 641.
Thank you. To the power of God's love to heal our brokenness. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of Christ be with you.
He's Dad and Nana, Mom. So, Nana.
Oh, Nana's on?
Peace be with you.
I'm not sure if you can see us.
Is it this way you see us?
Oh, yeah, you can see me.
Can you see us?
Yes.
I
don't know. Hello,
sorry about that, Brandon. That was such a mess. Did you experience
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Oh, no, it's dead. One more time. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Come on, that's what we do from one at a time. They better people. I don't miss that. All right, y'all. So first off, this is, I can't believe that this is actually happening. I woke up this morning full of emotion. I was in Vicksburg, Mississippi. I had a show last night. And we had an amazing show, great show. and we got back safely. But I woke up this morning, I was like, wow, this is actually the last Sunday for us to say, see you later, farewell, next trek, and all of that. And then when I got in here and I started to see all the stuff, I was like, oh my God, this is really happening. But you guys have done such an amazing, beautiful job of putting this together. You guys are reading my letter that'll come out later, my farewell or see you later letter, of just how much I love you guys and how much I thank you guys for all of the love and the support, and just giving me a chance. Y'all gave a boy from Woodstock, Tennessee, a chance, a little dusty country boy from Woodstock, Tennessee. And so y'all did not have to do that. I had no experience working with kids, really. I definitely didn't have any experience doing children's ministry, but I was excited. Lucy saw something in me. We sat right over there for 45 minutes. We had an amazing interview, and then I remember she called me and told me I had the job. And then I came and visited the kids. I did not get wet, no water. But it was just good to see them running around, and then, you know, the first Sunday we did all that great stuff. And so I really just want to say thank you for all of the love. 6 years, it's been a long, 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 good 6 years, a lot of members, y'all. So y'all clap it up for yourselves, please. Also, my mom and my god mom and my god aunt is here. Y'all wave your hand. Yes. So I always talk about my mom and my village. So that's the lady who raised me, who I am today. So we're gonna go ahead and get into this because I don't want to be crying up here all day because I don't miss y'all. So when we did a series in COVID time, it was called Everybody Has a Ministry. Y'all kind of remember that a little bit. I know we had COVID brain, a little bit, all that good stuff. But we did something called Everybody Has a Ministry, and I actually did my first, Patrick convinced me to do my first sermon. We don't call it a sermon because I was kind of afraid of doing the sermon. But I did it anyway, and it was called How to Work Your Garden. And it was crazy that I guess it was like 4 years or three, however long it was, that I did this, that I put this together, and then here we are today that I'm still working my garden, and I'm still preparing my garden, reaping the harvest, and all this stuff is in here. And so, coming from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10, it says, each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others, as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength God provides. So in all things, God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever. Amen. So, just like Jonah, I tried to run away from all the gifts and the talents that I had and possessed. Think about it. Some of y'all might have done the same thing. Whether it's coming up with an excuse of why you can't do something or not feeling capable of doing something. Or maybe just being afraid of what's to come if this talent really, really comes into fruition. Like, what if I really, really lean into the talent that God blessed me with? Many of us are so blessed that we have so many talents that we don't know what to do with them. I tell Zalisa this all the time. Then it doesn't make it any better when people around you may not understand your gifts or your talents or how they should be used. So, folks, Evergreen family, today it's my job to give you some insight on how to work your garden. That's right. Today we're all farmers. My dad is from Arkansas. He used to always say, boy, we come from Arkansas. You a farmer and we got all this land. Well, today, y'all, we are all from Arkansas and we are farmers, right? So the scripture tells us that we all have gifts, that they're not limited to your race, sex, demographic, or sexuality. All people have gifts. All people have talents. You can be young and have talents. You can be older in age with even more talents. It's about how willing you are to trust God with this talent that you've been blessed with. So, here are your four steps. The first one is to prepare your garden for your seed. Preparing your garden for your seed, in my opinion, is the hardest part of the process. because it's the most important part of the process. It's important that you build a strong foundation because nothing stands on a shaky ground. I remember when I began undergrad at Alcorn State University, everybody told me that your freshman year is your most important year, which y'all agree? Y'all agree that your most important year is your freshman year? Yeah. So it does, it determines how your undergrad career will play out. That's what they say at least. So if you start wrong, I mean, if you start strong, you'll be glad that you did later. Well, Mr. Corey's career didn't go like that. His undergrad career didn't go like that. Miss Betty and Mr. Matthew, so learn from this. It didn't start strong. I was lazy. I was complacent. My work didn't meet my faith, and my work actually didn't meet the teacher either because I wasn't doing it, which later led to me working harder towards graduation and almost not graduating college, y'all. I actually had to come all the way back home to Memphis, Tennessee from Mississippi because they took my scholarship, and I had to finish at home, and I had to do what I needed to do. Look at my mama looking at me. But I chose to finish anyway. I've always been determined. She knows that. I've always been determined to do what I needed to do. And I had time to self-reflect and hold myself accountable. I had to take time to listen to what she was saying and what everybody else was saying. And I allowed God to put things on my table instead of putting things on his. You see, a lot of times we try to give God tasks, but it doesn't work like that. We can make all the plans we want. We can say, we're going to do this year. We're going to lose weight. We're going to do this. We're going to eat this. We're going to get this car. We're going to do all this different stuff and have all these goals. But I know some of y'all can be the first to tell me that if they don't align with what God has planned for us, they will not be successful. God's plan is the only plan that will avail. And it's important to know that he's going to prepare a place for you. It's just your job to stay faithful over these few things so that one day you may be like ruler, king, queen, CEO, chairperson, or maybe the registrar and recruiter of the Stacks Music Academy. You never know. Thank you. Number two step is discover your seed. The first one was prepare your guard. Now you have to discover your seed. After you prepare your guard, it's time to explore and discover your seed. Try new things and find your passion. Never feel like you're too old in age to find a new talent because age does not determine the talent. It's how much you trust the talent and the God that gave it to you. I'll say it again. Never feel like you're too old to find a new talent because age does not determine the talent. It's how much you trust the talent and the God that gave it to you. For example, I'm going to use it as an example. I guess this is how preachers feel when they have like family and they can use like their life as them. So my mom just recently retired. Y'all clap it up for her, right? Now listen, I tell her all the time, mom, you ought to go make some banana puddings for people. You ought to, you know, make peach cobblers for people. She also is a great gardener. She's great at so many things. So now I feel like this is her time to find some new talents. Don't y'all agree?
Yeah.
See? Find a new talent, girl. Now, the main question is, do you trust God, and how much are you willing to trust God? Are you willing to feel uncomfortable? Because in those uncomfortable moments, that's when God wants you to lean not into your own understanding, but trust him. That's kind of what Mr. Corey has to do right now. I didn't know that this year would end up like this. I didn't know that I would be the registrar and recruiter for the Stacks Music Academy. I didn't know that we would be going on tour this year. I didn't know that September 29th will be my last day at the Evergreen Presbyterian Church. But God puts you in these positions for a reason. And all you have to do is trust. Give yourself the opportunity to fail, because in those failures is when we find our greatest strengths. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but he's given us power. And with that great power comes great responsibility. We find out how strong our faith really is. Now, that doesn't mean that you just go out here failing and trying to fail, but instead work from your position of strengths. It's an S on that, because we all have strengths. We don't just have one strength. We all have many strengths. Work from those positions of strengths that God gave you. Trust that his way is the way, he is the truth and the life, that Jesus will never leave you, never forsake you. My granny would always tell me that. And I tell myself all the time, you wouldn't be here had you not had the tools or had you not been prepared for this moment. Your job may ask new responsibilities of you. You may end a new relationship or friendship. You may start a new job. But will your heart say yes? Will your soul say yes? Will your spirit say yes? Because that's exactly what God wants to hear from us. Seeing as though there is more that he requires from all of us. Now, so you prepared your garden. You discovered your seed. Now it's time to protect and manage your seed. We're almost done. As we all know, with that great power comes great responsibility, and it's our responsibility to enjoy our journey. With that, though, we learn from the prodigal son that everyone will not be happy about your recovery or your good fortune. There'll be ups and downs, trials and tribulations. There'll be times that friends, colleagues, even family will not understand your talent or how you're using them or while you're trying to make a living for yourself, right? That's the big one, though. Every talent that you have isn't to monetize. It could be for the uplifting of God's kingdom. Some talents are literally just there just for that. And if you look for money every time God blesses you with an opportunity, you miss the opportunity. Did y'all hear that? If you look for money every time God blesses you with an opportunity, you already missed the opportunity. It was a young man who came with James Alexander from the Barclays this past week at Stacks, and he gave us three P's. It was position, pay me, and purpose me. He said that these three P's are the three P's that you should think about as an artist. He said a lot of times people just think about the first one, the pay me. And if it doesn't pay me, then yeah, I don't want it. But sometimes it may position you. Sometimes it may purpose you, and it's not paying you. So you have to look at it from a different lens sometimes. And don't just look at it just to get money because you missed the opportunity. Now, if God sees fit to compensate you for something that you love to do, that you can do in your sleep, then hallelujah, let God compensate you, you know? But you cannot allow the commentary of others or money stop you from getting to the Father. It's a tragedy to come to yourself and know that this moment is for you just to stay exactly where you are. Sometimes you gotta move. You have to know that while family feud is real, God has more for you than what your family may have already experienced as well. I promise you that you can break any and all generational curses. You can just trust your relationship with the Father is always secure. Just like in John 14, it says, let not your hearts be troubled. All right, so y'all repeat after me. Prepare your garden.
Prepare your garden.
Discover your seed.
Protect and manage your seed.
And reap the harvest of your garden.
Reap the harvest of your garden.
That's the last step. Reap the harvest of your garden. And lastly, not too long ago, I had a friend share with me this metaphor for me growing as an artist. It was a tree metaphor. You see, it takes a tree approximately 2 to 3, maybe even 5 years for it to actually start to grow. It takes 3 to 5 years for it to ever see apples from this tree. Now, maybe even 10 years for you to actually see apples from the tree. But guess what? Whenever you do start to bear fruit from this tree, you'll never stop bearing fruit. You'll always have fruit from this tree. And it's the same thing with God. You'll never run out of fruit with God. And so all you have to do is dream. Continue to dream. Don't let go. Another thing is you have to be thankful for the process. Be thankful for your purpose because that's what makes you who you are. And if you need additional reasons to keep going and know that God is with you, understand that he's a life giver. He's a heart and mind keeper. He's a need supplier. He's a mediator. He's an intercessor. And he's an advocate to the Father. And before I leave you, I want to leave you with this letter that my granny wrote for me. I've read this for you guys a couple of times. But along the journey, my granny would explain this life as a bus ride. And so I use this letter to continue on this journey, to continue to have joy and optimism and to, you know, keep my eyes on the prize. But she said, Corey, you've got to the place to where you've always wanted to get and where I prayed for you to be as well. But this is not the end. This is the beginning. Imagine that you're about to get on a bus, a long trip, long, long, long trip, and there will be many others getting on for the destination as well. When it's your turn, make sure you get on, but be sure to sit up front near the driver. As you're traveling on the bus, as you are traveling, the bus driver will make many stops. Some will get off, some will get on, and there'll be curves, there'll be mountains, there'll be valleys, but stay on the bus. Every now and then, you'll talk to the driver, and he'll see that you are enjoying the ride, the scenery, and that you're delighted in him. He's going to take you exactly where you need to go. Just make sure you don't get caught off guard, because you are trained, you are prepared, and you are developed. You know who you are and whose you are. Stay in faith. God has commanded the angels to watch over you. Stay in the shadow of the Almighty. He will keep you and assist you. Don't let anyone steal your joy. You are in control. Keep the right perspective. God bless. I love you dearly. Evergreen, thank you so much for an amazing 6 years. I'm on your phone call away. I'm a text message away. I can't wait to see Rosalyn when she grows up so I can tell her that she used to like run around and stuff. I can't wait to see what Miss Betty's gonna do when she grows up. I can't wait till you become president, Mr. Matthew. Just make sure you don't forget about me. Sylvia, when you become the next Picasso, wherever you are, just make sure that you draw a picture of me, please. And y'all just continue to keep being yourselves. Y'all are an amazing church, an amazing congregation, an amazing body of people. I wish it was more people that looked like you in this world, that loved like you. The world would be a much better place if we had more spaces and places like this, like Evergreen. So thank y'all for loving on this little dusty boy from Woodstock, Tennessee. I love y'all.
Each week in worship, we practice silence. So I'll ring the chime to bring us in and then ring it again in a couple minutes to bring us out. But as Mr. Corey mentioned, everybody has gardens and talents. What are the gardens of your lives and how can you water them? We'll start our silence now.
The church offering isn't just the time where we pass plates around to receive money for the mission and ministry of the church. It's also a time where we get to reflect on, the theme of Corey's message, of what are those gifts that we have? What is it that we can offer to the community? What is it that we can offer to the wider world for the sake of love and justice and God's dream for a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful creation? And I'm grateful that during this time of offering, we also get to hear Corey's offering with his song. Gracious God, for what we have to offer, for what our garden can grow, we give you thanks. And we pray that as we share it with the world, it goes to your dreams, to your beauty, to your love, and that it is a witness to your goodness. Amen. You're invited to rise in body or spirit as we sing our doxology together, the words printed in your bulletin. So, obviously we'll be sending you off with a warm reception and a special thanks. I would love a round of applause for Linda and Kelsey, and I think Renee overdid some of it, so all these folks that helped with the reception. Thank you for making that happen, and please, if you're visiting with us today and you're thinking, I don't even know who this Corey guy is, that's fine. There's food, hang out here, enjoy the reception. But most of you in this space do know who this Corey guy is and love him. To know him is to love him. And so I wanted, in addition to the love offering and the notes, to send him off with a commissioning. this commissioning is a sort of prayer, a sort of blessing of what we hope the Spirit of God will do as Corey moves on to the next track. So let's pray to God and hear these words as we commission Corey to move forward. Corey, you came to us years ago just out of college, as you said, a dusty country boy from Woodstock, Tennessee, eager to jump in. You came to us, this group of mostly white, quirky, slightly irreverent Presbyterians. You came to us in search of a faith community where you could offer your love, your enthusiasm, your faithfulness, your talents, your joy. And you have given us a gift in your presence, in your eagerness to serve, in your energy, in your compassion, in your dreamings, and in your loving heart. You gave us a young man who wasn't afraid to tell children that he loved them every week. You've reminded us that together we can, that teamwork makes the dream work, and that even us grown-ups can pause for some time to wonder. We're an imperfect community, but I hope we have loved you well. I hope that you have felt welcomed, beloved, befriended, affirmed, challenged, comforted, and inspired. And I hope you have been reminded that you belong to the living God, the God who called you to great and meaningful things since before your birth, the God who knew you long before you breathed your first breath, long before you sang your first song or danced your first dance, even before the formation of the muddy Mississippi River. You have been known, claimed, called, and loved by God since the foundations of the universe. So now, as we close in prayer, there'll be a moment where you are invited to shout words of affirmation toward Corey or hopes that you might have for him in this next step. God, we give you thanks for the ministry that you have done through Corey's work here and through his loving heart. And now we hope that you hear these words, these affirmations, these hopes that we lift up for Corey as he moves on to the next track.
Hospitable.
Caring.
Inspiring.
Musical.
Willing to try anything.
Kind.
Joyful.
Generous.
Together we can.
Faithful.
Righteous.
Optimistic.
Encouraging.
Rammy.
Selfless.
Rammy.
Jump from the bus, now on a freight train.
Sing boldly.
Persistent,
innovative,
keep shining,
getting better,
determined,
community leader,
lifelong learner,
keep wondering,
boundary breaker, talented.
Continue to nurture your inner child.
Encourager.
Big hearted.
Friendly.
Compassionate. And then I keep your money.
John Legend.
Yeah! Delightful. Gentle. Christian. Christmas pageant.
God, we give you thanks for all these things, for all these hopes, for who Corey has been, for who he is, and who you are calling him to be. And we trust that he feels this love, the love from you and the love from his village, those who are here in this circle and his village that is much bigger than this circle. For all of that friendship, for all that support, we give you thanks. In your loving name we pray. Amen.
Friends, my name is Beatrix. I'm Evergreen's Parish Associate Pastor and Chaplain at Rhodes College. And we're about to enter into a time called Prayers of the People, when we multiply our joy and divide our sorrow, because our sorrows are easier to hold when we hold them together. The way this works is that you will shout out some prayer to lift, or you'll type it in the chat. Susan will do her best to summarize, I will do my best to summarize, and then all together we will say, oh God, hear our prayers. He tells us that Jesus hears the prayers of our hearts before we even lift them, before we can even form words for them, even when they are just the groaning and the pain inside of ourselves, or even the celebrations that we cannot put to words. So we seal these prayers using the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We are about to sing our closing hymn, and I just had two quick things to say about that. If I haven't had the pleasure of meeting you, my name is Catherine, and I have the true joy of leading music here at Evergreen. So our closing hymn is number 549. It is short and sweet, very sweet. Grab your hankies. So we will sing it through twice, but before Patrick does a spoken benediction, this hymn was specifically chosen as a musical benediction for our beloved Corey. So if you are not Corey, my ask of you as you sing this is to just pour every bit of love and adoration and appreciation and gratitude that you have for him, put it in the song. Let this just be a blessing that covers and really enfolds our friend as he takes his next steps. So just put all your heart into it and all your good feelings and love for Corey. If you are Corey, just receive it and let it wash over you. So that's note number one. The second one is a little bit more school marmish, but I know for the postlude, usually chairs become ejector seats the minute the postlude begins, but our ask today, the choir is singing the postlude and we hope the congregation will join in. So please keep your seats after the benediction for the duration of that song. The hot wings will be waiting, and if you sneak off to get one, Jesus will see you. So just keep your seats, and all will be well. Hymn 549, and we will sing it through twice.
Every day,
That was so beautiful. Thank you. I don't have anything to say other than I love y'all. Thank you. Again, thank you, thank you, thank you. As you go out into this world, share love with others. The love that you want for yourself, share with others. Cherish the people that are around you, cherish your family. Work your garden. All of y'all have gifts, talents. All of y'all are farmers in your own way. And all of you know what you and God have been working on. So keep working on that. Keep doing what you're supposed to be doing and find those new talents. And again, I love y'all so much. So let's go eat. No, wait, after the song.
We all have pain. Thank you.